Friends, good afternoon and welcome to Reset Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in chemistry, in the series of natural products, we will talk about proteins, monomer, amino acid. To discuss this topic, we have with us our subject expert, Dr. Sushila Singhal. Dr. Singhal is assistant professor in Department of Chemistry in Deshpande College, University of Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome ma'am to our studios and request her to start the lecture. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Ambichi. Good day, viewers. Today we have started the new series, which is on natural products and spectroscopy. So we'll start with the natural products and we will discuss about today's the important macronutrient, which is protein. So we will discuss about the smallest moiety which is present in this macronutrient, which is called as the amino acid. In today's lecture, we will discuss about the amino acid, how it is discovered, how these amino acids has been named, and then the classification of these amino acids, that how these are classified on the basis of relative number of functional groups, on the basis of their nutritional importance, on the basis of the nature of the side chain. Then we will discuss about the stereochemistry of the amino acid, and in the second module we will discuss about the preparation of amino acid, that how different amino acids has been prepared by different name synthesis. One of them is the Stecker synthesis. We can synthesize these amino acids by Gabriel thalamide synthesis, by Coop synthesis. We can synthesize from ethyl malonate by the Curtius reaction, via Hydantoin synthesis, by Smid's reaction, and the oxidation of amino alcohols. So we can prepare these amino acids by a number of ways. So starting with the introduction of the amino acids, that what are these moieties? These amino acids, as the name itself suggests, that it contains two functional groups together in a same molecule. One of them is the amino and one is the base, is the acid. So it contains an amino group as well as a carboxylic acid group in the same molecule. So these are called as amino acids. These are the organic compounds which contain both these amino and the carboxylic acid group in a same molecule. Many alpha amino acids have been isolated from the natural sources, and the polymer which is made from these amino acid is the protein. These proteins, upon hydrolysis, they yields the amino acids, and therefore these amino acids can be termed as the monomers of the proteins. If you see the structure of the amino acid, the general structure of the amino acid, it contains an amino group, it contains a carboxylic acid group, and it contains a R alkyl group. When this alkyl group is present at the alpha position, these R group can be an alkyl group, it can be an aryl group. So by changing this, by substituting this R group, we can get different amino acids. Now if this alpha, if this amino group is present alpha to the carboxylic acid group, then it is called as amino acid, which is the alpha amino acid. Here you can see that this is the general formula of amino acid, and by substituting this R with the hydrogen, we will get here the simplest amino acid, which is called as the glycine. It is the first member of the amino acid series. Now we have substituted this R group with the methyl group, and after substituting with the methyl group, we will get the second molecule of the amino acid, which is named as the alanine. So by changing this R value, we will get the different amino acids. Now we will discuss about that how these amino acids have been discovered. In 1806, the history of the discovery of amino acids started with the isolation of asparagine from the asparagus juice. And in the 1820, the first amino acid was isolated from the protein material. A high molecular weight protein, which is named as the gelatin, it was cleaved by digestion, or it is hydrolyzed by digestion with the dilute hydrochloric acid. Then the cleavage products were separated and a major component of the product was identified. And after identification, it was found that it is an amino acid which has a similar structure as that of the glycine. So it was given the common name glycine because of its sweet taste. Now after 1820, threonine amino acid was also isolated from the protein fibrin. Thereafter, many additional amino acids has been isolated from the known protein sources also, such as antibiotics and bacterial cell walls. Now comes the nomenclature of amino acid, that in the wide word, that how these amino acid has been named. So amino acids are named analogously to the hydroxy acids with the amino groups that they are present at which distant, designated as alpha, beta, gamma, and it may be delta also, to indicate its position on the chain of the carboxylic acid, which is called as its common name. Now, if you see in this structure, in the glycine, that this amino group, it is present at the alpha carbon to the carboxylic acid group. So these are the alpha amino acid. And in the second molecule, you can see that this amino group, it is present to the beta position of the carboxylic acid group. So these are the beta amino acids. Generally, all naturally occurring amino acids are alpha amino acids. And all amino acids has been abbreviated, which usually consist of the first three letters of the amino acids as a common name. For example, if we talk about glycine, so we can abbreviate the glycine molecule as GLY, gly, and alanine as the ALA, and so on. In all the amino acid series, we will take only the first three letters of that amino acid, and we will write a peptide chain or a protein chain like that. Now comes the classification of amino acid, that how these amino acid has been classified. The first one is the depending upon the relative number of amino group and the carboxylic acid group. The subcategories are acidic amino acids, basic amino acids, and the neutral amino acid. So the first one is the acidic amino acids. As the name itself suggests, that amino acids, it means one amino and one acid group is already there, and we are adding one more acidic word in it. So there will be a more carboxylic acid group in the side chain. So these acidic amino acids are the amino acids which contain a carboxylic acid group in their side chain. Examples of these acidic amino acids are aspartic acid, glutamic acid, and glutamine. Then comes the basic amino acids. As the name itself suggests, there will be a more additional basic group, which is an amino group in its side chain. So examples of these basic amino groups will be lysine, arginine, and the histidine. Then the third subcategory is a neutral amino acid. Neutral means it is having one amino group and one carboxylic acid group. So they contain only one amino group and one carboxylic acid group. Examples of this class is the glycine, alanine, valine, leucine, and the isoleucine. Now these neutral amino acids, these can be further classified as aliphatic neutral amino acids, aromatic neutral amino acids, sulfur containing neutral amino acids, and the heterocyclic neutral amino acids. Now first category is the aliphatic neutral amino acids. These amino acids, they contain either hydrogen or an alkyl group or a hydroxyalkyl group in their side chain. Examples of this class is the glycine, alanine, valine, leucine, and serine. Then comes the second category, which is the aromatic neutral amino acids. Aromatic means these contains an aromatic rings in their side chain. Examples are phenylalanine and the tyrosine. The third category is sulfur containing neutral amino acid. It means there will be a thio group in the side chain, as a thiol group SH in case of cysteine, and a methyl thio group as in case of methionine in their side chains. The last category is the heterocyclic neutral amino acids. In these amino acids, they contain a heterocyclic ring such as an indole ring or a pyrrolidine ring in their side chain. Examples of these heterocyclic neutral amino acid is the proline, hydroxyproline, and the tryptophan. Now comes a classification which is depending upon the nutritional importance. Depending upon this category, these amino acid has been classified into three categories. One of them is the essential amino acid, then comes the semi-essential amino acid, and then the last one is the non-essential amino acids. Essential neutral amino acids, essential itself means which is very important to the body. Now we consume amino acids either from the plants or from the animals. Plants can synthesize all the different alpha amino acids, whereas human beings cannot synthesize all of them. So these are required to be taken externally through the diet and are termed as essential amino acids. For adult humans, there are 10 amino acids which are essential, and in the series of the amino acid, these essential amino acids are abbreviated by the symbol, the small e. Small e will be written along with the amino acid, which will explain its essentiality. Valine, leucine, isoleucine, phenylalanine, these are the few examples of these essential amino acids. The requirement of each essential amino acid for an adult human body is in the range of 1 to 2 grams per day. Their deficiency may lead to many disorders in the body. Most proteins from the plant sources, they are deficient in one or more essential amino acid. If we talk about the cone protein, which is termed as a gene, it is deficient in two essential amino acids. One of them is the lysine and one is the tryptophan. The countries where corn is a major food, there the people, they suffer from these two essential amino acid deficiency, or it is termed as a protein deficiency disease, which is called as kwashiorkor. This problem generally occurs in the children, in the growing children. It not simply is the starvation, but it is the breakdown of the body's own protein. So it is a deficiency which is because of the deficiency of these two essential amino acids. Then the protein which is extracted from the rice, it is also short of lysine and threonine. Now if we talk about the wheat protein, which is a gliadin, it also lacks lysine, and the soya protein, it also lacks a methionine. Lysine and methionine are the two essential amino acids that are frequently short in the plant sources. Proteins which are derived from the animal sources, they are the complete protein. As we talk about the milk protein, which is a casein, casein contains almost all the 19 out of 20, the 19 amino acids which are of essential ones. Therefore, the protein which is derived from the milk is a complete protein. Now, a balanced diet, it should consist of about 20% protein by weight and must include all the essential amino acids in sufficient quantity. Because a vegetarian, they takes only the plant protein, they are at the risk of malnutrition. So, it is advised to take them to take a mixture of amino acids, which leads to the concept of complementary proteins. Then comes the second class, which is the semi-essential amino acids. These amino acids are not synthesized in the human body in the sufficient amount during growth. However, these are essential in pregnant women, lactating mothers, and in the growing children. These amino acids have an important role as growth promoting nutrients. Arginine and histidine are the examples of this class. Then the third category is the non-essential amino acids. These amino acids can be synthesized in the human body from other materials through a series of biochemical reactions. So these are not required to take from the external diet or from the plant sources. So these are the non-essential amino acids. Example of these amino acids are glycine, cysteine, glutamine, aspartic acid, and a few other examples are there. Now comes a third classification, which is depending upon the side chain, whether the side chain is a polar chain, whether the side chain is a non-polar chain, what is the hydrophilicity and the hydrophobicity of the side chain. So depending upon the nature of the R group, there is a classification which has four categories. One of them is a non-polar side chain, one of them is the polar side chain, then acidic side chain, and the basic side chain. First of all, we'll discuss about the non-polar amino acids. Non-polar molecules are the hydrophobic molecules. Hydrophobic means these are water repellent molecules because they usually lack the ability to interact with the water molecules to make the intermolecular forces with the water molecules. They usually lack the ability to form hydrogen bonds, the ionic bonds, and any other sort of dipole interaction with the water. 10 amino acids have non-polar side chains, meaning that they do not interact with water. Glycine is the simplest amino acid of this class. Alanine, valine, leucine, and isoleucine, which have carbon up to the 4 carbon number, and their side chain are hydrophobic, and hence these amino acids are located in the interior of the protein where they are unable to interact with the water. Proline is also an hydrophobic side chain. It is interesting to note that it is unique in the case of proline, as the side chain of proline is bonded to the nitrogen atom of the amine as well as the alpha carbon. Therefore, thereby they forms a cyclic structure. Thus, proline is an amino acid instead of an amino acid. The amino acid cysteine and methionine, they have sulfur in their side chain. Methionine is quite hydrophobic, but cysteine is less, as it has sulfahydryl group in this amino acid. Cysteine plays an interesting role as it can form disulfide bonds between two cysteine residues of the side chains of two proteins. The two amino acids, phenylalanine and tryptophan, they contains the hydrophobic aromatic rings. So there is a subclassification of these non-polar amino acids. One of this is the which contains the alkyl part, and one of the amino acid which contains the aromatic side chains. Then comes the polar amino acids. These are also termed as the hydrophilic amino acids. The five amino acids have the polar side chains, but these are uncharged. Examples of this class is serine, threonine and tyrosine. They contains the hydroxyl groups in their chain. Asparagine and glutamine, they have the polar amide groups. These proteins, they interact with the water to form the hydrogen bonds, and therefore these are termed as the hydrophilic amino acids, and they are generally located on the outside of the proteins. The next subcategory is the negatively charged amino acids. These are the acidic amino acids. The remaining two amino acids, the aspartic acid and the glutamic acids, they have carboxylic acid in their side chain, and hence they are acidic in nature. These are hydrophilic and are located on the outer side of the protein. Often these are involved in the active sites of the enzymes in hydrogen bonding interactions and in the acid-base type reactivity. Then comes the last category, which is the positively charged amino acids, also termed as the basic amino acids. The three amino acids have side chains with the charged basic or the positively groups. Lysine, arginine and histidine amino acids comes under this category. So the polarity of these groups will determine the shape of the protein molecule also, that depending upon the hydrophilicity and the hydrophobicity, that the protein will twist in which manner the protein dipeptide chain, polypeptide chain will make a bigger protein. Also, these polarity of the R group will decide the tertiary structure of the protein, that how the tertiary structure will shape the enzyme molecules and the active sites of the enzyme. So, the classification which is based on the R group is much important than the previous tools. Here we have shown you all the four type of amino acids, the non-polar, polar, acidic and basic. Non-polar are the hydrophobic, and the examples of these are alanine, valine, leucine, proline, phenylalanine, and this is the R group. This R group can be the alkyl group. Here we have shown alkyl group. It can be an aromatic group also. In case of polar group, which are hydrophilic group, there we are having this hydroxy group in the side chain. This is the example of threonine. In the acidic amino acids, which are negatively charged, where we are having a more carboxylic acid group in the side chain, and in the basic, which are the positively charged group, which are we are having the amino functional group in the side chain. So these are the few examples of the amino acid groups which is based on the side chain. Then comes the stereoisomerism of amino acids. Glycine doesn't have an asymmetric carbon atom, and therefore it doesn't have the optical isomer, but in the all other amino acid except glycine, we are having a chiral carbon atom. So because of the chiral carbon atom, there is a existence of optical activity. So alanine and all other amino acids, they have chiral carbon at position number 2. So the alpha, which is the alpha carbon atom. So for this reason, because of this optical activity, there is the existence of two forms, which is the D and the L form. And these D and L forms are the known superimposable mirror images isomers. Now recall, that these two letters D and L, capital D and capital L, these refers only to the relative configuration around the asymmetric carbon atom. It doesn't have the relation with the direction of the optical rotation, which is indicated by a plus sign or by a minus sign, which designates the dextrorotatory and the levorotatory of the rotation of the optical activity of the optical beam. So these D, capital D and capital L, they are the only relative configuration of the amino acids. Now if the carboxylic group as, is written on the top of the Fischer projection of amino acid, the D form will be of that isomer in which we are having the amino group on the right side of the isomer. And in case of L amino acids, these amino group, this amino group will be on the left side of the mirror image of the isomer. So these, this D, when it is on the right side, it will be the D amino acid, and when this amino group is on the left side, then it will be the L amino acid. And the reference compound for this assignment is taken as the glyceraldehyde, which is a 3-carbon sugar, 3-carbon carbohydrate, in which we are having, instead of this amino group, we are having the hydroxy group. So when the hydroxy group is on the right side, there it will be a D glyceraldehyde. If it is on the left side, it will be the L glyceraldehyde. So taking the reference compound glyceraldehyde, we have designated the amino acids also. Most of the naturally occurring amino acids have the L configuration. The product of the laboratory synthesis are generally optically inactive. This is because there is a formation of racemate which contains the equal amount of D as well as the L. The optical rotation of the amino acid, it depends upon the pH of the solution. In neutral solution, most of the amino acids are dextrorotatory. Another method to assign the configuration of a chiral molecule is to use the R and S notations. Now let us consider a simplest chiral amino acid, which is the first one, which is the alanine. And now we will assign its configuration. We have taken here the alanine molecule. First we will convert this alanine molecule into its Fischer projection. Now this is the L-alanine, and here we have drawn the wedge diagram of this alanine molecules. These two dark bonds are the bonds which the groups which are close towards us, and these are which are at the farthest, which are far from us. So this is the wedge diagram. Now since the R configuration has been obtained by the one interchange of the groups, so L-alanine should be the S configuration. This is the wedge diagram of the alanine molecule, and we have done the first interchanging of the groups, that we have taken the least priority group on the farthest side, on the lower side, and then we have interchanged these two groups, and by changing these group we have taken the priority order, that on the basis of CIP rules, that amino group will get the priority number 1, then the carboxylic acid group, and then the methyl group. And here the clockwise direction is going on, so it is a R configuration. And after the second interchange, changing the positions of the these two groups, we will get here the S configuration. So all R all L amino acids will having the S configuration. Similarly, all the D amino acids should be R of R configuration. Now after this, now let's start with the preparation of alpha amino acids, that how these alpha amino acids have been prepared by different synthetic methods. One of them is the Strecker's synthesis. In the Strecker synthesis, the scientist Strecker, he has treated an aldehyde with the hydrogen cyanide to form the cyanohydrin derivative, which is made to react with ammonia to first form the alpha amino nitrile. Now this alpha amino nitrile, when hydrolyzed, it will give the corresponding alpha amino acid. Here we have taken two examples. One of them is the formaldehyde. When it reacts with hydrogen cyanide, first it will make cyanohydrin by nucleophilic addition reaction. Then after reaction with ammonia, it will make alpha amino nitrile, and after hydrolysis it will yield the glycine. And here we have taken the acetaldehyde. when acetaldehyde will react with hydrogen cyanide, it will give cyanohydrin, and likewise after a reaction with the ammonia and after hydrolysis, it will give us the alanine. Now we will discuss about the mechanism of this reaction, that how it will take place. Now in the mechanism, first the formation of this alpha aminonitrile, how it takes place, it probably involves the nucleophilic addition of hydrogen cyanide first to make the amine, which is then formed by the which is already formed by the condensation of the aldehyde with the ammonia. So in the previous reaction we are saying that cyanohydrin is first formed and then it is reacting with the ammonia. However, in the mechanism we are seeing here that first this aldehyde, it is reacting with the ammonia and it is making this amine. This amine is formed, and now this amine, here the nucleophilic addition of hydrogen cyanide is taking place. This cyanide nucleophile is there. So this cyanide is adding on, and this hydro is adding on the amine, and we are getting here the alpha amino nitrile. Now this alpha amino nitrile will undergo hydrolysis to give us the glycine. In a modification of this reaction, an equimolar mixture of ammonium chloride and potassium cyanide is used instead of more dangerous hydrogen cyanide. This method is useful for the synthesis of glycine, alanine, serine, valine, leucine and phenylalanine, etc. For example, glycine has been synthesized by this route, that we have taken here the formaldehyde. When it reacts with the ammonium cyanide in the presence of acidic medium, first it makes the aminonitrile. Now it will react with the barium oxide in the presence of water. On heating, it will finally give us the glycine amino acid. Then comes the second preparation method, which is by the amination of the alpha halo acids. The alpha halo derivative of the carboxylic acid is treated with the excess of liquid ammonia, first to form the ammonium salts of the amino acids, and now these amino salts of amino acids, now they will undergo hydrolysis to give us the amino acids. Here we have taken two examples. In the first example, the alpha chloroacetic acid, it will react with the ammonia in excess. And here the ammonium chloride, NH3 from here, H from here, and Cl, NH4Cl will go out as a side product, and we will get here a ammonium salt of this alpha chloroacetic acid, which upon hydrolysis will yield us the alpha amino acetic acid, which is named as the glycine. In the second example, we have taken here the alpha bromopropanoic acid. When this alpha bromopropanoic acid is reacted with the excess of ammonia, here the ammonium bromide will go as a side product, and we will get here the ammonium salt of this ingredient, which will undergo hydrolysis in the acidic medium and finally will give us the alpha amino propanoic acid. The name of this acid is the alanine. Now the alpha halo acid, which is required for this synthesis, can be prepared by a Hell-Wohlhardt-Zelanski reaction as follows, that acetic acid when reacts with chlorine in the presence of phosphorus, the halogenation takes place at the alpha carbon of the acetic acid, and here we will get the alpha chloroacetic acid. We can do the alpha bromopropanoic acid preparation also, starting with the propanoic acid. That propanoic acid when reacts with bromine in the presence of phosphorus, here again the halogenation will takes place at the alpha carbon, and we will get here the alpha bromopropanoic acid. Then third synthesis comes is the Gabriel thalamide synthesis. In this synthesis, an ester of an alpha halo acid is treated with the potassium thalamide to form the substituted thalamide. The compound formed upon hydrolysis gives the thalic acid and the alpha amino acid in a very good yield. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome back. After the synthesis of Gabriel thalamide synthesis, there is a modification of this reaction, which is the thalamidomalonic ester synthesis. In this synthesis also, we will first take the potassium thalamide. Now, this potassium thalamide will undergo condensation with the bromomalonic ester. And after reacting of this potassium thalamide on the bromomalonic ester, the potassium salt from the potassium thalamide and bromo from the second moiety, KBr will go out as a side product, and we will first get a condensation product, which is a thalamidomalonic ester. Now, this thalamidomalonic ester, it is having an active methylene hydrogen. Now, it is heated with the required molecule of the alkyl halide, and then this product is hydrolyzed to get the phenyl alanine. These reaction we have already studied in our previous lecture, the active methylene compounds, where we have studied that these active hydrogen is substituted by the alkyl group, and then there is a acetic as well as there is a ketonic hydrolysis. So here also we have hydrolyzed the product, and we are here getting the thalic acid from this part, and here we will get the, this will convert into the H2, here we will get C double bond O, OH, OH, it will convert into the thalic acid, and then half part will convert into the amino acid, and from this reaction we will get here the phenyl alanine. This method is used for the synthesis of acidic amino acids such as serine, aspartic acid and the glutamic acid. For the synthesis of aspartic acid, we will take the second ingredient, the bromomalonic ester. The first ingredient will be the same in all the synthesis of the these reaction. So here we have reacted this potassium thalamide with the bromomalonic ester. Here again the KBr will go out as a side product, and this moiety will attach with the nitrogen atom, and we will get here the thalamidomalonic ester. Now again, since we are having the active methylene carbon in this molecule, it will react with the sodium ethoxide and with the ethyl chloroacetate, and we will get this product intermediate. Now it will again undergo hydrolysis in the presence of KOH, hydrochloric acid, and on heating will give the decarboxylation in the will give the decarboxylation in the molecule, and we will get here the aspartic acid. This hydrolysis will be done from this part, that it will make the thalic acid, and here we will get the amino group. Now since we are having two ester groups in the same molecule, so first they will hydrolyze to make the two carboxylic acid group on the same carbon atom, then decarboxylation will take place, and we will get here the aspartic acid. Then comes the synthesis of glutamic acid. It is also similar to the previous one. Here we also we have taken the potassium thalamide. Now it will react with the bromomalonic ester. Here again the first step is similar, and after removal of KBr we will get here the thalamidomalonic ester. Now we have done the alkylation part, which is the different, and here we have taken the ethyl crotonoic acid, crotonoate. So after these two steps we will get here that this part of the molecule will attach on the carbon atom. Now after hydrolysis, again hydrolysis will be done on this side, and we will get one of the thalic acid and then the glutamic acid. So these were the synthesis which we are getting from the malonic esters. Then comes the synthesis of methionine molecule. In case of methionine, the potassium thalamide, when it reacts with bromomalonic ester, the first step we are getting the thalamidomalonic ester, and in this malonic ester, since we know that methionine, it contains a sulfur moiety in it, so we will take the desired alkyl group, and we will take here the chloro, ethyl chloro, and we will do the substitution on the active methylene carbon, and this hydrogen will be substituted by the second alkyl part, and this alkyl part will come on this carbon atom. Now again the hydrolysis will take place, and we will get here this part, the amino acid, which is the methionine. Then comes the synthesis of proline. For the synthesis of proline, we will take the potassium thalamide along with the bromomalonic ester. Here again the first step, we will get here the thalamidomelonate ester, and for the alkyl part here we will take the dibromo derivative of alkane, and after the substitution of this actinomethylene carbon instead of this hydrogen, we will take this moiety. This moiety will come on this carbon atom, and after hydrolysis we will get a alicyclic chain, which on hydrolysis in the acid medium will then cyclize on from this side, and we will get here a cyclized amino acid, which is the proline in this case. Then comes the synthesis of cysteine and cysteine. Benzyl thiomethyl fluoride is prepared first, and then it is condensed with the N-thalamidomelonic ester. Then the product is hydrolyzed and is reduced to obtain the cysteine. So the first ingredient along with the thalamidomelonic ester that we have to synthesize, which is the benzyl thiomethyl chloride, and for this we will first take this molecule along with the formaldehyde in the presence of hydrochloric acid, and here the condensation will take place and we will get here the benzyl thiomethyl chloride. Now this molecule will react with the thalamidomelonic ester. This is the alkyl moiety which we have synthesized in the previous reaction, and now this moiety HCl will go out and this part will attach on this carbon atom. Now the hydrolysis will take place and we will get this part as a product, which is the main product. Now we are getting here the cysteine. This is the cysteine amino acid. Now we are saying that we can prepare cysteine from cysteine. So this when undergoes air oxidation, the two molecules of these cysteine molecule will undergo disulfide linkage, and the first molecule of cysteine along with the one more molecule of cysteine will undergo disulfide linkage to give us the cysteine amino acids. So we can synthesize these type of amino acids from the thalamidomelonic ester synthesis. And these methods, they yields the racemic mixture of the amino acids. So to obtain the optically active enantiomer of the amino acids, we have to resolve the mixture, and for the resolution of the mixture we have to carry out a resolution method, which is by treatment with a chiral reagent. When we take the racemic mixture of the amino acid and will react with the chiral molecule, which is a resolving agent, first we will get here the mixture of diastereomer salts. Now these two, the mixture of these two diastereomer salts can be separated by fractional distillation, can be separated by other distillation methods, and from there we can get the different amino acids. So we can resolve these amino acids by the reaction with the chiral molecules. Then comes the next synthetic method by the reduction amination of the keto acid, which is also called as a Coupe synthesis. In this case we have taken here the keto acids. When these keto acids are treated with ammonia, first they forms the amine. Keto acids which contains alpha keto group along with the carboxylic acid groups, when they react with the ammonia, first amines are formed. Now these amines can undergo reduction with the chemical reduction as well as with the catalytic reduction. So here we have taken the catalytic reduction. When it reacts with the platinum, it reduces, this amine reduces to give us the amino moiety, and which will make it a leucine amino acid. The oxymes and phenylhydrazones of alpha keto acids, they can also be reduced to the alpha amino acids in the same manner. Here we have taken the keto acid. First we have make its oxime by reaction with the hydroxylamine. When ketones reacts with the hydroxylamine, they forms the oxymes. And when keto acids, when ketonic groups, carbonyl groups are treated with the phenylhydrazine, they forms the phenylhydrazones. Now these two phenylhydrazone and oxymes, when these are reduced either catalytically or biochemically, from here we can also get the leucine as the final product. Then comes the alpha oxymino acids are also obtained by the treatment of the 2-alkyl and the 2-acyl acetoacetic esters with the butyl nitrile in the sulfuric acid. whereas the action of a diazonium salt in the presence of sodium ethoxide affords a corresponding phenyl hydrazones. The reductions of these can be carried out to get the amino acids to get the alpha amino acids. So here we have taken the esters of these keto acids which are treated with the butyl nitrile. When they are reacted with the N-butyl nitrile in the presence of acidic medium, here we will get the oxime of these esters, and we can react it with the diazonium salt also, and here we will get the phenyl hydrazones of these corresponding keto acids. Now when these two oxime and the phenyl hydrazones are reduced, then we will get the amino acids. The usefulness of these methods depend upon the availability of the alpha keto acid, that which alpha keto acid is available. From that we will get, we can get here the alanine, phenyl alanine, leucine amino acids by this method. Next important method is by the Erlenmeyer S-lactone synthesis. In this method, first we have to prepare the S-lactone moiety, which can be prepared by the benzoylation of the glycine. When glycine molecule, glycine is itself an amino acid. So in this synthesis, we are preparing another amino acid from a simple amino acid. We have taken here the glycine. Glycine in the presence of benzoyl chloride first undergo benzoylation to give the benzoyl glycine. Benzoyl glycine is termed as a hippuric acid, which is present in the urine of the horses. This compound, this benzoyl glycine, is then condensed with the acetic anhydride in the presence of sodium acetate to give the S-lactone molecule. First, this benzoyl glycine, we are having here the ketonic group. It undergoes enolization, and we will get here the enolic form of this benzoyl glycine. Then it will react with the acetic anhydride in the presence of sodium acetate, and the cyclization will take place to give the S-lactone moiety. Now this S-lactone, it will react with the aldehyde, with the aromatic aldehyde, in the same manner as in case of the Perkin condensation. In case of Perkin condensation, the aromatic aldehydes are reacted with the compounds which are having the active methylene compounds, and we can get there the alpha beta unsaturated acids. Here also this S-lactone, it will react with the aromatic aldehyde. Here we have taken the benzaldehyde. These two will undergo condensation, and we will get here this moiety. Now this product formed is then reduced with the hydrogen iodide in the presence of phosphorus, and then hydrolyzed to give the amino acid. This moiety first undergo ketonization. Here we are having the enolic form, it will undergo ketonization, and after hydrolysis we will get here the phenyl alanine molecule. This benzoic acid will go from this part, and we will get this amino acid. The name of this amino acid will be the phenyl alanine in this case. Then comes the synthesis from the ethyl malonate. Primarily the ethyl malonate is converted into the ethyl acetyl amino malonate in the three steps. So first we have taken the ethyl malonate when it reacts with the nitrous acids. It forms this imine. When this imine undergoes reduction in the presence of nickel, it forms ethyl amino malonate. And now this ethyl amino malonate will undergo acetylation in the presence of acetyl chloride, and we will get here the substitution of this amino group. The HCl will go out, and we will get here the acetyl amino malonate. Now this acetyl amino malonate, on treatment with the sodium ethoxide in the absolute alcohol from a sodium salt and in the second step alkylation will be done, and we will get here this alkylation on this carbon atom, and we will get this moiety. Now this moiety will undergo hydrolysis with the basic hydrolysis, which is also called as saponification in case of esters. When it reacts with NaOH, the hydrolysis will take place on both the ester groups, and we will get here the two carboxylic acid groups. Now, since two carboxylic groups are present on the same carbon atom, on heating decarboxylation will take place and we will get here the alanine amino acid in this case. Then comes the synthesis of serine. In case of serine, we will take the acetyl amino malonate, and now it will react with the formaldehyde and the sodium hydroxide, and here in substitution on this carbon will take place, and we will attach here this one more carbon atom, and for this this alcoholic group will be attached, methyl alcohol will be attached on this carbon atom, which upon hydrolysis again these two ester groups will be hydrolyzed to give the dicarboxylic acid, which on decarboxylation finally will give us a serine amino acid. Then comes the synthesis of the leucine amino acid. For the leucine amino acid, for the alkylation, we will take the bromo derivative of this alkyl chain, and this alkyl chain will be substituted on the chiral asymmetric chiral carbon atom, and here the substitution will take place, which again by the hydrolysis followed by decarboxylation will give us the leucine amino acid. Then comes the synthesis of the histidine amino acid. For histidine amino acids, we will react it with this moiety. Now this moiety will attach on the asymmetric carbon atom. This is the asymmetric carbon atom. Here we will attach this moiety, and this on hydrolysis followed by decarboxylation will give us the histidine. Then comes the Curtius reaction. These are the Curtius reactions, Smid's reaction, Beckmann reactions. These are the intermolecular rearrangement reactions. So in case of Curtius reaction, by this method the amino acids like glycine, alanine, valine, these can be prepared. For this we will take the malonic ester. When it react with the sodium ethoxide followed by alkylation, we will get here the alkyl derivative, which on reaction with the potassium hydroxide will make its potassium salt. Now when this potassium salt of this alkylated malonic ester reacts with the hydrogen, when it reacts with the hydrogen, there the now this hydrogen will attach on this ester part of this the previous molecule, which on reaction with the nitrous acid will first form the azide. This is the azide molecule which is formed in the Curtius reaction. Now this azide, when reacts with alcohol, first it makes the ester, and which on hydrolysis with the hydrochloric acid will finally give us the amino moiety, which is the amino acid. In case of malonic ester, we can also take the other active methylene compound, which is the ethyl cyanoacetate. So here we have take the ethyl cyanoacetate, which can also react with the sodium ethoxide as well as alkyl halide, can be alkylated, and now again it will react with the hydrazine followed by nitrous acid and the alcohol, and then by the hydrolysis here again we will get here the amino acid. The next synthesis is the Drapsi synthesis. In this method, an aldehyde when condensed with the ethyl cyanoacetate, this is the aldehyde, when it reacts with the ethyl cyanoacetate, it undergoes the catalytic hydrogenation, and simultaneously in the previous reaction, in the Curtius reaction, the remaining steps will be the similar as that of the Curtius reaction, and now it will react with the hydrazine followed by the nitrous acid, then again with the alcohol followed by the hydrochloric acid, and these steps are similar. So first we will make here the azide. This azide on reaction with the alcohol first again make the ester, the amino ester, which on reaction with the hydrochloric acid will finally give us the amino acid. Then comes the synthesis via the diketo piperazine, the aromatic aldehyde. When condensed with the diketo piperazine, here for the aromatic aldehyde we have taken the benzaldehyde, the two molecules of benzaldehyde, when reacts with diketo piperazine, they yields the products. This is the intermediate products, which on heating with the red phosphorus along with the hydroiodic acid, they produces the corresponding alpha amino acids. By this method we can prepare the phenylalanine, the tyrosine and the methionine. Then comes the hydantoin synthesis. In case of hydantoin synthesis, hydantoin itself is prepared by the treatment of the glycine with the potassium cyanide. The active methylene group can then be condensed with the aldehyde, and the desired product can be obtained by the reduction followed by the hydrolysis. The synthesis of the tryptophan we have taken for the example of this hydantoin synthesis. In this synthesis, first we have taken the alpha amino propanoic acid. When it reacts with the potassium cyanide, first it makes this hydantoin structure, this cyclic structure. Now when this hydantoin structure, it is reacted with the aromatic aldehyde, here we have taken this aromatic aldehyde, in the presence of acetic anhydride, the dehydration will take place from these two positions, OH from here and oxygen from here, water will go out and condensation will take place on this carbon atom. This we have inverted the structure and we will get this moiety. Now this moiety, this intermediate structure, when undergo hydrolysis, first it is undergoing reduction in the presence of sodium and mercury, and by reduction we will get here the single bond. This hydrogen will be added on this carbon double bond and we will get here CH2, here again the CH2, this double bond has been converted into the single bond by the reduction, and now this is undergoing hydrolysis to make this amino acid. The amino acid, this is the tryptophan amino acid. Then comes the synthesis of the amino acids through the Beckmann rearrangement. This Beckmann rearrangement is again a molecular rearrangement in which molecules are rearranging itself in a concerted mechanism. There is no stepwise mechanism. They are simultaneously the electrons and the bonds are moving to make the rearrangement product. So the Beckmann rearrangement of the cyclopentanone, here we have taken the example of cyclopentanone oxime. First the oxime has been prepared, the cyclopentanone oxime, they gives the omega amino valeric acid. First we have make the omega amino valeric acid starting from the cyclopentanone. Cyclopentanone when reacts with hydroxylamine, first they makes the oxime of this cyclopentanone, then after reaction with the 30% sulfuric acid, the cyclization will take place. This ring is the number of the ring size has been increased, and we will get here a 6-membered ring instead of the 5-membered ring. And now this 6-membered ring, when undergoes hydrolysis, first they give the hydrolysis will take place on this amide bond, and we will get here the omega amino valeric acid. Now this omega amino valeric acid, when reacts with benzyl chloride, here we have taken the benzyl chloride. The benzyl chloride will do the substitution on the amino group. This amino group will be protected by the benzoyl moiety, and we will get here the benzoyl derivative of omega amino valeric acid. Now it will undergo HVZ reaction, which is reaction with the bromine with the halogen in the presence of phosphorus, and this reaction does the halogenation at the alpha carbon of the carboxylic acid group. So here we will get the bromination on the alpha carbon of the carboxylic acid group. So bromination will take place. Now from this moiety we can get 3 different amino acids. If we hydrolyze this molecule, then after hydrolysis we can get directly the proline. And now if this moiety is first reacted with the ammonia, this bromine, this bromo group will be then substituted by the amino group, will be replaced by the amino group. Now if this moiety is hydrolyzed, then we will get here the ornithine amino acid. This ornithine amino acid is further reacted with the amino nitrile, then we can get here the arginine amino acid. So from this reaction, from the Beckmann rearrangement, we can get different amino acids starting from a simple omega amino valeric acid. So what is the Beckmann rearrangement, how the molecular rearrangement is going on in this reaction. For this, we have taken the general mechanism of this rearrangement, the Beckmann rearrangement, in which we are taking the oxime. This is the oxime. When oxime in the acidic medium, we take the oxime in the acid medium, they rearranges. How they rearranges? That it will accept a proton and it will become the OH2. Now this OH2 will go as a water moiety, and this will make the nitrogen as the electron deficient moiety, since water will go with along with the lone pair. So it will leave a positive charge on the nitrogen atom. Now this is a relatively unstable moiety. So the alkyl part of the molecule, within the molecule there is a intramolecular rearrangement. The alkyl group from the carbon atom is going on the electron deficient nitrogen atom. So this R will come on the nitrogen atom, and this rearrangement will take place to give the carbon double bond nitrogen. And from here we will then it will again the water accept the water molecule, since it is a carbocation. Then it will lose a proton and will give us the keto group. It will then undergo rearrangement. Then comes the synthesis through the Schmidt's reaction. It is again a similar reaction with the Curtius reaction. Here again in this reaction the alkylate and malonic acids are reacted with the azide, with the hydrazoic acid, and here we will get the amino acids in the acidic medium. By applying the Schmidt's reaction on the cyclic ketones, we will get here first the by reaction with the hydrazoic acid, the cyclic chain will be increased, and then it will undergo hydrolysis to give us the amino acid. The lysine can also be prepared by this Schmidt's reaction. These two steps are similar. By when these are reacted with the benzoyl chloride, here the benzoylation will take place on the amino acid, which will undergo the HVZ reaction followed by the amination and followed by hydrolysis. We will get here the lysine moiety. This is the proposed mechanism for this Schmidt's reaction. Then comes the synthesis by the Hofmann degradation. This is again a type of intramolecular rearrangement reaction, in which the ester amides are reacted with the bromine in the presence of sodium hydroxide, and first CONH2 group will be converted into NH2. It is a similar reaction as that of the Hofmann degradation reaction. Here the number of carbon atom is getting reduced in the final amino acid. The formal endpoint of this reaction is the presence of the isocyanate. In all the these rearrangements, there is a formation of this isocyanate molecule, which then finally forms the amino acid. Then comes the oxidation of amino acids. Oxidation of amino acids also give us the formation of amino acids, but these amino alcohols are rarely available, so this reaction is not of that importance. Then comes the amino acid preparation by the hydrolysis of proteins. That protein can be hydrolyzed first, then converted into the mixture of alpha amino acid, which can be separated by fractional distillation, by fractional distillation of their esters, by Coulomb paper and the gas chromatography, and by the electrophoresis reactions. So the mixture of alpha amino acids by the hydrolysis of proteins can be separated in this method. These were the methods of preparation of alpha amino acids. Here are the few questions for these classification and the preparation of amino acids. Thank you.
And dear friends, due to paucity of time, we have to stop our lecture here. On that note, we would like to thank Dr. Sushila Singer for coming here and delivering this wonderful lecture. And thank you, dear friends, for watching our lecture. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.